Simon & Schuster Audio presents Longstreet, The Confederate General Who Defied the South, by Elizabeth Varon, read by Fred Sanders. To David and Bensian. Prologue, Confederate Judas. 1. It was a quintessentially American scene. Although the event was slated to begin at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, the city square began to fill up hours earlier, as thousands of spectators gathered in eager anticipation of a venerable civic ritual, a militia parade, and flag presentation ceremony. Such occasions, in which volunteer citizen soldiers displayed their martial prowess and their patriotic devotion to the state, generally followed time-honored scripts. And this parade was, in key respects, no different from countless others that had come before. The arrival of the militia was heralded by the martial airs of a regimental band. Having made their way to the square, the troops drew up in line of battle and opened ranks, to be inspected by their officers and demonstrate their skill in marching in close order. The regiment then wheeled into column by companies and passed a reviewing stand, where dignitaries and distinguished guests, military and civil, looked on with approval. One might be easily excused for mistaking them for regulars, so admirable was their marching, crowed the local newspaper, comparing the militiamen favorably to professional soldiers. The militia formed a line of battle again, and its commissioned officers marched forward to receive a stand of colors, featuring a brightly colored flag bearing the coat of arms of the state, from the general who commanded the militia force. The general made a short speech in which he expressed his faith that if the troops were ever called into battle, they would do the state proud. The regiment's colonel, accepting the stand of colors on behalf of his fellow officers, then gave a speech of his own, expressing his sincere thanks for the honor you have done us and the confidence you have reposed in us. Such events had a timeless quality, as celebrations of the vital role non-professional soldiers have played in times of peace and war as auxiliaries to the standing, full-time, professional U.S. military. But this particular ceremony also marked a unique moment in American history, a moment of fleeting possibility. The year was 1870, the zenith of Reconstruction in the post-Civil War South. The place was New Orleans, a key proving ground for testing whether Reconstruction would succeed. The soldiers, the 2nd Regiment of the Louisiana State Militia, were African American. They pledged themselves to defend not only the flag of Louisiana, but also the flag of the Union. And positioned conspicuously in the reviewing stand, radiating his approval, was a man who had waged 4 years of bloody war against that very Union, the famed Confederate General James Longstreet. 2. Longstreet did not make a speech at this October review, but his presence spoke volumes. Like the militia's commander, a former Union colonel named Hugh J. Campbell, Longstreet was there as a representative of Louisiana's governor, Henry Warmoth, and of Warmoth's governing coalition. Warmoth had appointed Longstreet adjutant general, chief of staff, of the state force, in recognition of his military experience as a career soldier and, more important, of the bold and unlikely political position that Longstreet took on Reconstruction, namely, to support the U.S. Congress's ambitious, revolutionary program for remaking the American South. The centerpiece of its plan was the enfranchisement of black Southern men as voters and their inclusion in the body politic as citizens. In aligning himself with this program, Longstreet joined ranks with the Republican Party, the party of the North, of Lincoln, of emancipation, of Union victory, of everything Confederates had loathed and feared. The Republicans rewarded him with a major federal patronage position as customs surveyor in New Orleans, bestowed in 1869 by President Ulysses S. Grant, and with various leadership positions within the Louisiana party apparatus. Longstreet threw himself into his role as an agent of Reconstruction, in his capacity as a civil servant and warrior. As Hugh J. Campbell noted in his remarks during the October 1870 flag presentation ceremony, Longstreet showed every favor in his power to the black regiments in the Louisiana State Militia, seeing to it that they were properly armed, equipped, and trained, promoting the careers of the LSM's black officers, and according them from his position as one of the most illustrious soldiers of America, so Campbell put it, their rightful legitimacy and respect. Indeed, during the ceremony, Longstreet singled out one of the companies of the 2nd Regiment, led by United States Colored Troops veteran Captain R.R. Ray, for its drilling, praising it in the most complimentary manner, according to newspaper coverage of the event. Such a show of support was meant to nerve the men to do battle, as the regiment's colonel, James B. Lewis, intoned in his comments, with their ultimate enemy, that great monster, the most formidable of all, the caste prejudice that had so long subordinated Southern blacks. How did Longstreet, a man who had gone to war in 1861 to destroy the Union and perpetuate slavery, find his way onto that reviewing stand among his former enemies? This biography will answer that question, and in so doing, reintroduce Americans to one of the Civil War era's best-known but least understood figures. The basic outlines of Longstreet's story have long been familiar to scholars and the interested general public. During the Civil War, he commanded the Army of Northern Virginia's fabled 1st Corps and won laurels in Confederate victories at 2nd Manassas, Fredericksburg, and Chickamauga, among other battles, earning a reputation as Robert E. Lee's hardy and dependable war horse. Longstreet's post-war embrace of radical Reconstruction infuriated his fellow white ex-Confederates, who promptly cast him out of the pantheon of Confederate heroes, and then proceeded, in a decades-long campaign, to blame Longstreet retroactively for their defeat in the Battle of Gettysburg, as well as for the loss of the war itself. Longstreet's efforts to defend himself were muddled and contradictory, and he remained a social pariah, remembered in the South as Lee's tarnished lieutenant. The vast majority of popular writing and academic scholarship on Longstreet has revolved around the question of whether, militarily speaking, he deserved this fate. His performance as a commander in the Civil War, especially at Gettysburg, has been litigated over and over in painstaking detail, with various verdicts, mostly negative, offered on his generalship. But Longstreet's remarkable post-war political conversion, the very event that sparked the endless debates over his military leadership, has never been the subject of an extended, thorough account. Longstreet's 1867 decision to support Reconstruction launched him on a lifelong career as a Republican political operative and national celebrity whose iconoclastic positions on race relations, sectional reunion, military history, foreign affairs, and even marriage kept him consistently in the public eye. A prolific writer and speaker and interviewee who produced a vast oeuvre of political commentary, Longstreet ruminated at length on the issues of loyalty and treason, victory and defeat, progress and reaction. And his distinct voice can help us better understand both the transformative changes and the entrenched inequities of the post-war era. Longstreet was not, by the standards of radical Republicans and abolitionists such as Thaddeus Stevens and Frederick Douglass, a true racial egalitarian. But even his circumscribed challenge to the racial caste system, his insistence that blacks could exercise, through the Republican Party, a measure of political influence and leadership in the Southern polity, was a clear and present threat to lost cause orthodoxies. Defenders of the lost cause, such as Confederate General Jubal Early, insisted on the righteousness of slavery, secession, the Confederacy, and white supremacy. Longstreet rejected the conservative South's demand for ideological purity, and that was enough to cast him forever as an apostate in the eyes of those who rejected change. Longstreet was le Judas Confédéré, as the reactionary francophone New Orleans paper Le Carillon charged, to go along with the labels of Benedict Arnold, Lucifer, and other such favorites of the unreconstructed press. 3. Longstreet's political journey from ardent Confederate to ardent Republican was an exceedingly unlikely one. As this biography will show, his remarkable.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.